Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome. Thank you so much for taking the time out of your schedules to be here or for having your class with us today. We are psyched to have such a great turnout for such a fascinating and timely topic. So my name is Jessica Fish, and I am the director of the Center for Global Race and Diversity Studies. So before I dive into the talk today, I just want to get a show of hands. How many students here are English, history, anthropology, political science, social work, sociology, women's studies majors? Fantastic. Okay, put your hands down. How many people here are interested in issues of social justice? Fantastic. Okay, so everybody who put your hands up, I'm going to guarantee you that you probably already have at least one class that counts towards the following minors that I help run, which are Africana, African American Studies, Asian Studies, Middle Eastern Studies, Race and Ethnic Studies, Latin American Studies, Queer Studies, and American Studies. And a lot of students don't even know that these minors exist, but they do, and they're awesome, and they can really help give you a niche focus area, differentiate yourself on your resume. So a lot of you got a little quarter sheet handout when you came in. So I want you to take that. If you're interested in more information, I want you to put your email on the back and leave it on this front table. I ran out of quarter sheets because so many beautiful people showed up today. So if you're one of those gorgeous folks, you sign the legal pad right there on your way out, and I will email you with more information, okay? It's a great way to take charge of your education, minors that matter. Got it? There's a great little graphic right there. Okay. So moving on. We are here today because the Sidore family, about 30 years ago, made a wonderful memorial fund to the university to schedule important and timely cultural conversations throughout the year in a speaker series. And so we want to give our thanks today to the Sidore family for making the Saul O. Sidore Memorial Lecture Series possible. I want to give a big thanks to my co-organizers for the series, who are Mary Malone, who's right over there in political science, Jeannie Sowers, also in political science, and the fantastic Katie Humans. We couldn't do this without you. Can we just give Katie a round of applause? Because she has done so much of the organizing. All this heavy lifting, she's the reason why we have snacks. So we always want to thank that person. Okay, so one issue of housekeeping. We are recording this talk. Thank you, Michael. Yeah. So everybody, please don't record it yourselves. We have permission from Gabriella to do so. We will make it available on our website so that you can go back or share it with your friends. Okay, so without further ado, we are here for a lecture entitled Inside Anonymous by Gabriella Coleman, who holds the Wolfe Chair in Scientific and Technological Literacy at McGill University. She was trained as a cultural anthropologist, and she researches, writes, and teaches on computer hackers and digital activism. Her first book on free software, entitled Coding Freedom, The Ethics and Aesthetics of Hacking, has been published with Princeton University Press. Her forthcoming book, which we are told is making its way to the United States right now on boats as we talk, Hacker, Hoaxer, Whistleblower, Spy, The Many Faces of Anonymous. Seriously, movie rights pending, I hope. Will hit bookstores next month and has been called easily the best book on Anonymous by none other than Julian Assange. And the Huffington Post has said of Coleman that she knows all of Anonymous's deepest, darkest secrets. So it is with that we are delighted to have you here today. We hope to learn a couple of those secrets and get us thinking about how we conceptualize and think about activism in the digital age. And with that, big round of applause for Gabriella.
Hi, everyone. I first also want to thank the organizers, Katie, and everyone who made this lecture possible. It's a real pleasure to be here. It's really exciting to see so many people here out today. And I'm just going to jump in. I have a lot to say. The book is a long book. I still feel like I've barely scratched the surface. I think Anonymous truly is one of the most interesting, hard to understand phenomena, especially related to activism. And I hope to kind of, give you a little bit of window into Anonymous today, but I want to leave plenty of time for questions. But I'd like to first start with a couple of questions. Who here has heard about Anonymous? Okay. Who here has watched Anonymous video? Okay, so a smaller kind of group. Who here has maybe seen Anonymous on the news or in a news story? Okay, a bit more. All right. So I'm just going to jump in, but a bit of a sort of warning. For those that know Anonymous, they are, you know, extremely, extremely not politically correct. They love to be offensive and insurgent. And so if I'm going to talk about Anonymous, some of their kind of foul, offensive language is definitely going to come into the talk. And that's perhaps one of the things that we can talk about during the Q&A, the kind of politics of sort of saying screw you to politically correct language. All right, so here's a question without an easy answer. Who is Anonymous? I've spent the last number of years spending copious time with Anonymous on chat rooms, during protests, and interviewing participants. I still find this question has no easy, or at least straightforward, answer. Now, it's a name that's free to take. And in fact, Topiary, who was a member of Anonymous, he was also a member of LulzSec, right before he was arrested, he tweeted, "You cannot arrest an idea." And this is one of the reasons why Anonymous has kind of spread across the globe. So currently, there's various unrelated groups of hackers, technologists, activists, geeks, and also, of course, unknown parties who use the name Anonymous to organize very diverse genres of collective action. These have ranged from, you know, extremely humiliating hacks against security firms, and I'm going to talk about one in detail, to support for Occupy and the United States or the Arab revolutionaries. In some instances, you really get a lot of people participating, as was the case with one of their most famous operations, Operation Payback, when they rose up in support of Julian Assange after his organization suffered a banking blockade. They targeted the websites of PayPal and MasterCard in specific. But Anonymous can also involve very small groups, and these some of these groups, such as LulzSec and AntiSec, became particularly famous. These hacker groups violate the law by breaking into servers, and they're scouring for politically damning information to leak to the world at large. Now, what I find particularly fascinating and important, given all this political activity that has coalesced around Anonymous, is that really Anonymous is a historical aberration. Anonymous, at least when it comes to activism, is kind of a mistake. And just recently, I don't know, I tweeted something about Anonymous and politics, and someone who came from an earlier generation, Anonymous, who came from a trolling generation, if you don't know what that is, I'll get to that in a second, this person reminded me, just to be clear, Anonymous was never meant to be a political thing. Your Anonymous News, which is the biggest Twitter account around Anonymous, is not anonymous. Hackers are not anonymous. Good day. And this is a lol seeker. I actually wrote back, I was like, you know, I kind of agree with you. But they did become political, and that's a really interesting thing. And the reason why lol seeker said, to be clear, Anonymous was not supposed to be political, is because prior to 2008, Anonymous was a name synonymous with internet trolling, and also really associated with the image board 4chan. And so, you know, probably, who here knows what trolling is, internet trolling? Okay, so almost everyone, right? So trolls try to upset people by spreading grisly or disturbing content. Maybe they just try to ignite arguments, or they just want to engender general chaos. Trolling can be quite playful at times, but the chaos of feuding and flaming can be ruthless, sometimes really offensive and truly terrifying at times. It's an activity that seeks to desecrate the reputations of individuals and organizations by revealing embarrassing, humiliating, or just simply false information. Whatever the technique, trolls like to say what they do. they do it for the lulz, right? A kind of spirited but really kind of malevolent brand of humor that's derived from laugh out loud. So just to give you an example, I kind of give different examples of what trolling might look like. You know, there's kind of an endless archive. And I'll just give you one example of a troll that I guess was never successful. But it was against me on 4chan when people kind of learned that I was studying Anonymous. And so, you know, they kind of identified me and said, you know, I haven't delivered my tits yet, get the fuck out. Like very, you know, what trolls say. And, you know, they said, turn on her. And so, you know, here's a series of kind of posts which were like, let's go for her. And then there was also a series of posts who were just like, oh, you know, who gives a shit? Rule one and two are only for raids, and if we raid her ass, she'll probably just laugh and shrug it off because I knew it was coming. Also, there's a lot of people who've done research on B. At a certain point, trolling them all just seems silly. If she's studying us, won't she be expecting us? I found that one particularly funny. Kind of images of me with my head cut off. And so this kind of trolling campaign thankfully never actually caught on. Some do, some don't. But this is kind of a good example of what a trolling raid on Anonymous looks like. And as you'll notice, everyone kind of posts anonymously as well. And that's going to be important for later. So it's for this reason that Fox News in 2007 called Anonymous the Internet Hate Machine. And it was a kind of hyperbolic title that Anonymous nevertheless embraced, in part because it did capture the fearsome side of trolling. And so in 2008, Anonymous went through a kind of fascinating metamorphosis and really did a U-turn away from trolling. And so what I'm gonna do for the rest of the talk is just give a little bit of history from that period in 2008 to the present, so you get a sense of what they've done and how they've done it, because they are incredibly confusing and they really do mutate quite a bit over time. And then I just wanna, in the last part, talk a little bit about their kind of cultural and political significance, why they kind of matter, why they're distinctive. So, let's start with that transformation, and we have this man to thank, Tom Cruise, for really giving us Anonymous as we know it today. And so basically what happened was that someone within the Church of Scientology leaked a video of Tom Cruise, and it's a kind of hilarious video of Tom Cruise praising the church, and of course it went completely viral. And the Church of Scientology is very well known for being extremely litigious. It doesn't like it when their kind of copyrighted and trademark material gets out in the world. And so they threatened news organizations such as Gawker with lawsuits if you didn't take down this website. So Anonymous thought, huh, the Church of Scientology, now that is an organization that we would love to troll, right? And they basically engaged in what I think of still as the mothership example of Anonymous trolling, or in the words of Anonymous, in a previously unseen way, the greater non-community united to unleash a hearty load of fuck you upon Scientology's entire cult empire. And this kind of consisted of sending hundreds of pizzas to churches, pranking the Dianetics hotline, sending a lot of nude images through faxes to churches. And Anonymous was having a wonderful time doing this. And in part, they're having a wonderful time because this is a little bit of a kind of side point. But Scientology is kind of the evil doppelganger of the geek and hacker world, insofar as, you know, if there was something like a cultural inversion machine and you stuck geeks and hackers in there, you'd get something that looks like Scientology. It's a religion of science and technology, but the technology doesn't work. The science is really science fiction. It's extremely proprietary. And so I actually think that there's a real pleasure in attacking and protesting your perfect nemesis. But what Anonymous was doing was pure 100% trolling. But then, you know, one night a bunch of people got together in a chat room and decided to create a video. And they created the video for the lulz alone, for just the pure humor of it. And I'm going to show you this video and then talk about its effect afterwards.
Hello, leaders of Scientology. We are anonymous. Over the years, we have been watching you, your campaigns of misinformation, your suppression of dissent, your litigious nature. All of these things have caught our eye. With the leakage of your latest propaganda video into mainstream circulation, the extent of your malign influence over those who have come to trust you as leaders has been made clear to us. Anonymous has therefore decided that your organization should be destroyed. For the good of your followers, for the good of mankind, and for our own enjoyment, we shall proceed to expel you from the internet and systematically dismantle the Church of Scientology in its present form. We recognize you as serious opponents, and do not expect our campaign to be completed in a short time frame. However, you will not prevail forever against the angry masses of the body politic. Your choice of methods, your hypocrisy, and the general artlessness of your organization have sounded its death knell. You have nowhere to hide, because we are everywhere. You will find no recourse in attack, because for each of us that falls, 10 more will take his place. We are cognizant of the many who may decry our methods as parallel to those of the Church of Scientology, those who espouse the obvious truth that your organization will use the actions of Anonymous as an example of the persecution of which you have for so long warned your followers. This is acceptable to Anonymous. In fact, it is encouraged. We are your SPs. Over time, as we begin to merge our pulse with that of your church, the suppression of your followers will become increasingly difficult to maintain. Believers will become aware that salvation needn't come at the expense of their livelihood. They will become aware that the stress and the frustration that they feel is not due to us, but a source much closer to them. Yes, we are SPs, but the sum of suppression we could ever muster is eclipsed by that of your own RTC. Knowledge is free. We are Anonymous. We are Legion. We do not forgive. We do not forget. Expect us.
So this is a pretty great video. It's very well done. It's very clever. I like to think that it was, you know, a bunch of students who are avoiding their homework and actually producing something really interesting instead. They actually did research into Scientology. RTC, for example, is the Religious Technology Center, which is in charge of the intellectual property of the church, right? So they released this video. It goes completely viral. People love it, you know? And one of the interesting things was that people actually then started to take the video seriously, like within and outside Anonymous. And people are like, well, you know, maybe we should go to war against the Church of Scientology, like in a real way, not just like to screw with them, but they're kind of creepy, you know, maybe this is important. And this was a really big debate. Some people are like, no, we're just about the lulls. We're from the internet, you know, do not go there. But the debate kind of swerved towards, you know, deciding to protest the Church of Scientology. And they decided to kind of organize a global day of street protests, which happened on February 10th, 2008, in over 127 cities across the world with about 7,000, you know, internet geeks who showed up in front of churches in London and Birmingham, in Montreal, in Melbourne. It was pretty kind of remarkable. And this was really interesting because, you know, a lot of people showed up, I think, just to meet other people from 4chan, because 4chan really truly is Anonymous. It's very hard to accrue status or reputation. And I went to these early protests and people were like, yeah, I just really wanted to finally meet other people from this image board 4chan that I've spent so much time on, right? But there's something about, you know, protesting on the street once you experience it, combined with the fact that Scientology is kind of creepy, to the fact that then they got a lot of media validation. They were kind of splattered all over the news. And basically, from that moment on, Anonymous as a kind of activist project was constituted. And so Project Chinology was the name given to the Anonymous operation that fought Scientology legitimately. So this is when I started to jump in. It's a kind of interesting question as to why I came to Anonymous. I'm not going to talk about it, but maybe during the Q&A someone can ask me. But this is when I entered the door. And I always thought that then Anonymous was just a quirky aberration, a true historical mistake. Like, you get people on the street, you have these trolls, they become politicized, but they're always just going to protest their perfect nemesis, Scientology. But I was wrong. So between 2008 and 2010, you had ongoing trolling under the name Anonymous. Like that image I showed of me being trolled happened after 2008. Currently, there's almost next to no trolling under the name. But during this period, there was. There was Project Chainology. Anonymous was branching out a little bit, but not doing much else. The big player in town was WikiLeaks. And this was Collateral Murder, a video that they released thanks to Chelsea Manning that really caused a lot of waves. And it was a video of a patch of American soldiers in helicopters gunning down soldiers and kind of other citizens, right? And so WikiLeaks to me, as someone who studies hackers, was like, that was the big game in town. Anonymous, quirky, weird, super not politically, geopolitically significant. But then something happened. Again, another accident. And actually, this accident is not complicated, but it is, it would be a little time consuming to tell you all about it, but it truly was a kind of accident that brought a new anonymous node into being. So there's Chainology, and then there's a new node by the name of Anonops, and that was the name of their chat server. And they kind of constituted themselves in September 2010, and they constituted themselves in part to defend file sharing, piracy. This is what they were about. And one of the interesting things was that they really embraced digital direct action. So distributed denial of service attacks, when you overwhelm a web page with too many requests so you can't access it anymore, they love to use this tactic. And they also embraced hacking. Now, Chainology got really pissed at Anonops because Chainology decided to let go of the illegal tactics. But Anonops was all about digital direct action. That was their identity. And again, they were all about file sharing. But then something else happened, which was there was a banking blockade against WikiLeaks, and the internet was incredibly pissed off. I mean, I've never actually seen so many different types of geeks and hackers livid, even those who didn't necessarily support Julian Assange or WikiLeaks, but they felt like a preemptive banking blockade was basically skirting around due process. Julian Assange or WikiLeaks had not been found guilty of anything. So Anonops then decides as a little side project to support WikiLeaks. They're like, all right, well, you know, for a couple days, we'll stop our file sharing kind of political activity. We'll support WikiLeaks. And lo and behold, once they announced that they're DDoSing MasterCard and PayPal, I mean, it was like a volcano erupted. Insofar as a lot of those angry people who were voicing their discontent in different places all showed up on the Anonops chat server and chat room. So you had 7,000 people in one chat room, which is, you know, as far as I know, the most number of individuals in one chat room ever historically. There was a tool called Low Orbit Ion Cannon, LOIC, which people could download to contribute to the DDoS attack. There was over 100,000 downloads of that tool. Probably many people didn't use it, but nevertheless, there was like an interest, right? And this was just major. You know, this was major. This was first, you know, perhaps the first large-scale digital direct action event on the internet. There have been previous ones, but never at this scale. Well, what happens after this? Many things happen, but basically, first of all, Anonymous becomes a bit like a hydra. There's different wings and teams, and they're not in agreement over tactics. And this is very kind of interesting because Anonymous presents aesthetically and even ideologically a united face. But then below the surface, it's just like any political movement, but I would say it's particularly apparent in Anonymous, very, very prevalent, the kind of conflict over tactics. But the other interesting thing was Anonymous became anonymous everywhere, as I like to call it. And this really only happened once Anonymous jumped into Tunisia, which was the first country to experience the Arab Spring. And Anonymous was actually helping to shuttle out videos of the protests on the street when much of the mainstream media was kind of, you know, writing very tepid articles about the event. And then Anonymous started to DDoS Tunisian websites and started to hack websites. And what was interesting was this was a moment where all of a sudden Anonymous again went from like quirky Scientology to kind of censorship internet to like we could be about anything. And in January 2011, there were operations all over Latin America, the Arab Spring. It just became a fountain of activity. And this was when I, you know, basically became locked in and had to be attached to my computer for well over a year and a half to do my research. If I wanted to understand what was going on, I had to kind of be there. So I'm going to talk about one more shift, an important shift, and then a few more things. Get into one operation. But, you know, again, Anonymous is often described in the media as being like amorphous and chaotic. And I actually don't think that's quite right. There's often, you know, logics to Anonymous, but they are extremely unpredictable and experimental. So depending on some new situation, they experiment in a new way and new possibilities open. And there's no better example of that than H.B. Gary. H.B. Gary is a security company. There's two of them. There's H.B. Gary and H.B. Gary Federal. H.B. Gary Federal no longer exists thanks to Anonymous. But one of the workers in H.B. Gary was called Aaron Barr. And he supposedly infiltrated Anonymous. He did hang out in the chat rooms. And he came up with a list of what he called key operatives. And he went to a journalist and he gave them the names. And then he boasted to the journalist, I'm going to go to the FBI with these names. Actually, he just claimed he had the names. The FBI information came a little bit later, to be precise. But Anonymous felt threatened. You know, here was this person with supposedly the names, and they decided to ruthlessly hack H.B. Gary and H.B. Gary Federal. And it was kind of ironic because they're a security company, but they had like terrible security. So it was relatively easy one evening, Friday night, within a couple hours, they were in there. They were in there, and what did they do? They downloaded 70,000 company and personal emails, put them on the Pirate Bay, of course. They deleted a lot of files. They took over Aaron Barr's Twitter account and started spewing the most racist, you know, things you can say in 140 characters. It was revenge of the hackers, like completely. But what was interesting was, again, what they found in the emails. They found a proposal that H.B. Gary Federal was proposing, along with Palantir and Barrico, two other intelligence companies, to discredit WikiLeaks using kind of extra legal methods. And so there was a PowerPoint presentation, which we can see up here. And basically, you know, let's just take number three, cyber attacks against the infrastructure to get data on document submitters. This would kill the projects, and servers are now in Sweden and France. Putting a team together to get access is more straightforward. Media campaign to push the radical and reckless nature of WikiLeaks activists. Sustained pressure. Search for leaks. One of the things they also proposed was to discredit journalists such as Glenn Greenwald, who was supporting WikiLeaks. So anyone who knows the history of kind of American government politics might have heard of something like COINTELPRO, which was a secret government FBI program, which was about infiltrating activist groups and using illegal methods to create dissent and mistrust within them in order to destroy them. So this was very interesting because this was a proposal. It wasn't carried out, but nevertheless, it kind of made the hackers hungry, you know, to go search for information. And so soon after, you had breakaway groups such as LulzSec, which broke away from Anonymous, in part because when they broke away, they decided to go on a hacking spree against anything that was insecure, whether or not it was politically important. So that's why they retained the name LulzSec. But after 50 days, they retired, and a new group came into being, AntiSec, which was nothing but politically motivated. It was to go hack into government websites or into corporate websites to find this politically damning information. And again, the H.B. Gary kind of event helped set the stage for that. Soon after, was one of their kind of big mega operations, which I'm going to talk about just to give you a sense of what happens during an operation. And it's a nice one because it's an operation that involved hackers, but involved a lot of participants and also deployed legal, illegal, and morally gray tactics. Now, one operation may only, you know, use one of those tactics, or two of them, but this was one that brought all three of them together. And it was Operation BART from August 2011. So a little bit of background. In July 2011, the Bay Area Rapid Transit, which is the transportation system in San Francisco, the police there killed a drunk homeless man, Charles Hill, and local activists were, you know, quite upset at this. They felt like there was a record, a tradition of police brutality, and they organized protests against BART. Officials decided to shut off cell phone access in the stations in order to quell future protests. And so a lot of people in Anonymous felt that this was censorship, and that's why they're kind of making the ties to Mubarak, and decided to intervene. So what did they do? They organized street protests, right? We could see that up there. They hacked into the BART website. That's the defacement that they left on the page. They also released customer data, which was very controversial outside and within Anonymous. And then someone went ahead and doxed or trolled the spokesperson, the BART spokesperson, Linton Johnson, and basically found some, you know, semi-nude pictures of him and put it up on a website. And so we could see Your Anonymous News saying, Linton Johnson, we have 14 embarrassing photos of you. You have 24 hours to step down. And the person who puts up the website says, you know, if you're going to be a dick to the public, then I'm sure you don't mind showing your dick to the public, right? And so I use this example because, first of all, it shows that Anonymous still uses these dicey trollish techniques. They tend to use them a little less often than they would if they were just pure trolling. But this is definitely a movement with certain bite and teeth to it. And you know, basically, because of how controversial this is, even within Anonymous, actually soon after this event, more because of the hacking than actually because of this, releasing customer data was really something that upset a lot of people within Anonymous. And there was a kind of press release that was issued soon after, which basically says, Anonymous is not unanimous, right? And it's interesting because on the one hand, you know, people in Anonymous often disagree and they do engage in a blistering war of words, but very little energy is spent on trying to eliminate difference, especially related to tactics. And it's almost impossible to do so because the name is free to take, right? There are some kind of control mechanisms in place, but they're very hard to kind of issue. Now, many operations, I just want to emphasize, have nothing lulzy about them, nor does it come up. So, you know, Operation Guantanamo, which was calling on the president to make do on his promise to release prisoners who really should not be there, you know, something lulzy never comes up. It just depends on whether there's something to kind of exploit an opportunity or not. Now, just very briefly, I'll talk about the last 2 years, but you know, there's a lot that's happened, so I'm not going to mention too much except some kind of major developments in this period. And one of the major developments has to do with the fact that a lot of people have actually been arrested because of the hacking activity or the DDoSing activity. And most of the high-profile arrests have come in the United States and Europe. But actually, if you take, you know, the globe into perspective, there's been over 100 people all over the world. Just some hackers in Hong Kong supporting the protests there were just arrested. Some people have argued, I think correctly, that this constitutes a nerd scare, which is, you know, riffing off the Red Scare, in which a lot of kind of communists were arrested in the United States. And if you, you know, take into account, you know, Julian Assange, Chelsea Manning, the kind of dozens of arrests in Europe and the United States. It's pretty significant, actually. And, you know, in the United States, the charges tend to be pretty hefty, and the fines tend to be pretty hefty as well. As you might expect as well, any political movement in the United States and much of the Western world, if there's illegal activity, there's informants implanted as well. And most famously, this fellow on the right, Hector Monsegur Sabu, who was a key hacker in LulzSec and AntiSec, had been arrested, and he flipped in one night on June 7th, 2011, and he was a very charismatic figure, extremely charismatic figure. And he worked as an informant pretty much nonstop until March 6, 2012, when Jeremy Hammond, the fellow on the left, was arrested, and now he's doing a 10-year sentence here in the United States. So there's probably others, but this is the only one that was revealed, and it was revealed by Fox News on the same day that Jeremy Hammond was arrested. So today, you know, Anonymous has a very weird kind of social life. They kind of come and go. So in 2011, 2012, they were extremely, extremely active. After a lot of the arrests, a lot of the hacking activity continued to emanate in other parts of the world. So it's very, very active in Latin America. LulzSec Peru, for example, hacked into the Peruvian government and got a bunch of emails. There was a great article in the Associated Press about them. A lot of the Latin American Anons are very active in helping in operations in Palestine, for example, and other parts of the globe. But they tend to wax and wane, you know, and in the context of the United States, there was very, very little activity for most of 2014, except for during the Israel-Palestine conflict. They came out in full force, and then you probably kind of saw them in Ferguson, which had to do with the shooting of a young African-American man. And again, really fascinating, and really, it caught me off guard. They had been quite silent for a while, and then next thing you know, they're really involved, making videos, doing live streaming, incorrectly identifying one of the police officers, which I can talk more about during the Q&A, and landing massive media attention. And again, forming ties of solidarity with groups that you wouldn't normally imagine Anonymous would form ties with. And just to finish like the historical little part, this is just you know, a week ago, where in Hong Kong you have hackers who have been arrested. And again, there have been hackers arrested in Singapore, Cambodia, Australia, many different parts of the world, and it's very hard to kind of tally up and really know what's going on everywhere. We have a really good sense of what's going on in Europe, but in the rest of the world, it's a little bit harder. So I'm going to now just transition for the last part of the talk to talk a little bit about kind of why they matter. Like, how should we think about Anonymous, right? And here, I mean, I could talk about this forever, but I'm going to just concentrate on, I think, three or four points and go over three of them quickly and go into depth with one of them. But one of the things that's quite interesting is that Anonymous is really but one example of a wellspring of political activity among geeks and hackers. There's countless geeks and hackers from São Paulo to Sydney who understand how the internet works, a smaller class who know how to subvert the protocols of the internet, and a larger number who will rally when the internet and the values associated with it, like privacy and speech, seem to be in peril. More than ever, a lot of these geeks and hackers are breaking out of the internet frame or the civil liberties frame to engage in other political issues. I don't think that this should be taken for granted. Why now? Why are we having this explosion of what I call weapons of the geek? Now, for the academic professors in the room, Weapons of the Geek is a remix of a very famous book, Weapons of the Week, by James Scott, an anthropologist who looks at peasant politics. And Weapons of the Week are a kind of modality of politics that don't look political. They're small-scale acts of sabotage and foot dragging that on their own amount to nothing, but in their aggregate can have a political effect. Many of the weapons of the weak protagonists do everything not to call attention to themselves. Weapons of the geek are like the almost opposite, right? These are not economically or socially marginalized actors. They tend to have a lot of, if nothing, technical power. They call a tremendous amount of attention to themselves, right? And I think it's really quite interesting that they are increasingly engaging in politics and doing so in very different ways, right? There's kind of this idea that geeks and hackers are simply kind of libertarian and express themselves through technology. I don't think this is right at all. They're reinventing the law, as is the case with free software. They're leaking and whistleblowing. They're reinventing journalism. They're providing privacy internet service providers like RiseUp. They're going into the traditional political sphere, such as you have with the pirate parties, right? And I can't really get into why there's this kind of explosion, but I'll just mention one thing that is important. So sociologists who work on social movements identify something that they call free spaces. A free space in this literature are things like radical churches, woman-only bookshops, unions, bar clubs. They're kind of autonomous spaces where people come together, where kind of dominant values don't reign and kind of other values, other ethics can be explored and experimented with. Well, hackers have a ton of these free spaces. They're called bulletin board systems in the past, mailing lists, internet relay chat, hacker conferences, right? And this is incredibly important. They not only have them, they can build them, right? They're much lower cost, and there's spaces where they can come associate freely, where they talk about both, you know, the things that they love as hackers, computers, and they also talk about politics. So this is a really important precondition that under the right historical circumstances then can take off politically in these interesting ways. So Anonymous is part of this weapons of the geek family. I would say that they're the most difficult to understand and also quite different and interesting because of the fact that they meld these characteristics. They are very grassroots, although they're very secret as well. And you might think grassroots and secrecy don't go together, but they can. They sit in a lot of tension with each other, but they can go together. They're very participatory insofar as, again, the name is free to take. Once a node is created, there's, of course, rules of engagement in terms of how you show up and how you can participate. And then again, they've really, really kind of embraced direct action as a technique that you use online. And so these are some of the kind of characteristics that make them stand apart. Now, the other one that I think is extremely interesting is how they fuse art and politics so closely together. And as I talk about this, I'll just leave one of their great images up there. So there's a lot going on with this fusion of art and politics, and I'm just going to mention a couple of elements. But they give visual flesh to what's hard to represent, computer hacking, for example. Like, you know, if you look at Hollywood movies, when they represent hacking, it's often totally ridiculous. You know, it involves guns and five screens and, you know, explosions, when actually, it is actually quite boring when you look at it, but from the perspective of people doing it, it is very exciting. And there is something about the fact that they use so much art that kind of helps give some visual flesh to this. The other thing that I think is really interesting is that you have an example here of life imitating art. And here I mean V for Vendetta, the movie. A lot of people in Anonymous watch the movie, which features Guy Fawkes. The movie in particular really speaks to modern conditions of censorship and scary totalitarian states. But here you have, again, life imitating art, but in such a way that retains the aesthetic performative element, right? It doesn't sideline the art in any way. The other characteristic is that the art is not vanguardist or all that kind of original. A lot of it is it's very dramatic in a lot of ways, but it's a lot of stock imagery that a lot of people can use. And they kind of repurpose Hollywood aesthetics. And I think that this is interesting because, you know, the art in particular kind of mitigates or attenuates the technical vanguardism. So there is technical vanguardism, like the more technical power you have, like you're able to do more things in anonymous. But the art kind of allows more people to kind of come in, and even the hackers themselves know that if you don't have the propaganda, you don't get the message out as forcefully. And I think another really interesting element too, and it's a bit more complicated than the art question, but it relates to it, is that the US government has tried extremely hard to frame anonymous as cyber terrorists. There's a couple examples, but one that I just came across recently was by Janet Napolitano. She's the Secretary of Homeland Security, and she claims that when discussing potential cybersecurity threats, we often used anonymous as Exhibit A. There was another very famous article in the Wall Street Journal that featured ex-NSA director Keith Alexander, who claimed that anonymous had the potential to take down the electrical grid. There's no evidence that they wanted to. I think that was an attempt to kind of frame them that way, but it hasn't worked so far. We are bastards, not terrorists. And I think part of the reason has to do with the huge aesthetic element. That's one. The other is a kind of historical accident or contingency. The photo up on the left is of Polish parliamentarians in February 2012, who were protesting a copyright treaty in Europe, and they decided to use the mask as part of their protest. And after that, it was kind of game over. If you have, you know, politicians taking on this symbol, it makes it much harder to claim the symbol is about terrorism. And actually, that Wall Street Journal story came like out right after this. And to me, that was a kind of attempt to control the narrative. But again, I think like the artistic aesthetic elements also kind of contributes to framing it as kind of activism. Finally, the other kind of aesthetic element has to do with the art of transgression and breaking rules. You know, breaking rules is a very difficult thing to do. I often ask my students to do it for a class project. And most of them, you know, like they have to break a rule in a social situation. I'm not asking them to break the law. And most of them break rules by doing things like sitting next to someone at a cafe they don't know. I'm like, ooh, daring. You know, like it's just so viscerally hard for people to break rules, you know? And I think anonymous is interesting because it's a domain in which people are breaking normative rules around language, breaking laws. And I do think that it's a kind of art to it, and you've got to make it sexy, and they've kind of figured out all the pieces to that. Closely related, and this is a third frame, is that anonymous, I kind of consider them and frame them as contemporary tricksters. And for those that don't know what a trickster is, think figures like Puck from Shakespeare's Midsummer Night's Dream or Loki. These are kind of moral figures who are difficult to pin down because sometimes they, you know, do good, sometimes they do bad. They often are very unpredictable. They like to kind of create chaos. And they are also very adept shapeshifters. They change form very easily. And I think all these characteristics actually really align with anonymous well. And in fact, there's one word that you could apply to the trickster, which I think, you know, really applies to anonymous, and that's mercurial. They're changeable, volatile, fickle, flighty, erratic, animated, lively, sprightly, and quick-witted. And so there is something of the trickster spirit that I think exists among trolls as well as anonymous. And I just want to mention one thing, because I think oftentimes with tricksters, when I mention them, people think, oh, this is just, you know, a way to kind of celebrate anonymous, because the trickster figure is often celebrated as a figure that renews culture and politics. And I think that's true, but tricksters, the reason why I like them is that some tricksters are kind of like just total, you know, motherfuckers. I mean, they really are. You know, they're scary figures. You know, and actually, I think certain trolls, contemporary trolls, are the Lokis of the world, and that makes them particularly frightening, you know? But they exist, and they cause certain effects. So I think the trickster can be used not simply to kind of celebrate the culture of transgression, but also understand what happens when transgression has no boundaries. Shit can go really bad very quickly. So, now the last point, which I'm going to spend a little bit more time and just wrap up with. I think what is really interesting about Anonymous is how they teaches the virtue of opacity in the high age of surveillance and celebrity. You know, it's really kind of fascinating how just at the moment where anonymity's value has sunk to new lows, and by this I mean a lot of people think that anonymity is a problem online, and it does cause a lot of problems, but I still think it's very valuable in other ways. So just as the moment where anonymity has suffered new lows and threats to privacy have soared to new highs, there's a protest movement that has come into being almost accidentally that has configured itself around this motif of concealment. And I think what is really fascinating is that while there's many different ways that cloaking works in Anonymous, there's really, and a lot of these forms of cloaking are used for self-protection, there's a lot going on ethically when it comes to concealment. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that because I think some of the most important things coming out of Anonymous have to do with this. Now, first of all, just a little bit of sociology of anonymity. So in Anonymous, the activist wings, you interact pseudo-anonymously, not anonymously. That means you have stable handles and nicknames and you accrue reputations, right? This is a big difference. But because of this, people had to use a lot of technical security and other techniques not to reveal personal information about themselves. But this also meant that people got very close. And it was a psychological burden not to share stuff about your life with each other. You had to be very tight-lipped. And in fact, some people just couldn't do it. And Jeremy Hammond, the hacker who's now in jail for 10 years, he had excellent technical security, but he had mentioned that he had done jail time in federal prison before. And that was kind of a dead giveaway as to who he was. So another hacker who actually was successful in not revealing anything about his life said, "The hardest to me is the silence. When we have trouble and stress, unlike family or work tensions, there's no one to talk to, no friends who understand or who had trust with it. The advantage is Anonymous can resurrect and work in again. For you, I will keep following Biella. There's no nick changes for you." So he's sort of saying, "I really enjoy talking to you because I know who you are, but it's very difficult to not be able to talk to others about it." Now, along with just the kind of self-cloaking for protection, there's a very sophisticated kind of set of vocabularies around concealment. So one is, you know, part and parcel, I would say, of the liberal tradition, and it's been put well by Oscar Wilde, who says, "Man is least himself when he talks in his own person. Give him a mask, and he'll tell you the truth." Others actually like masking for trickery, and for performance. But despite the differences in ethical vocabularies around concealment, there's one universal one, and it's this one. There's an extremely robust taboo against celebrity seeking and fame. Like, this is not okay. And you know, sure, if you're doing illegal action, you're not gonna go like bandy about your name, but many people are organizers or making videos and they will not kind of reveal their name, and it's extremely taboo to do so. And I'm gonna show you a conversation right now between two people, one who's accusing another one who went public with his name for seeking, you know, fame and status. And again, there's strong language because it's anonymous. "Hey, can I say you really love attention or some wannabe? Wouldn't be surprised if you're some faggot fed, just like Sabu, this hacker who became an informant. And then this other person's trying to just defend himself. You can say whatever you like, but you'd be wrong." And this kind of came up over and over again. People were constantly marginalized if they were public about the self. This is just simply not okay. And what's interesting is that this ideal, in some ways, was partially formed on 4chan, the image board from where they came, because of the way people could experience creation irrespective of creating status and reputation. So one person, anonymous, lectured in my class via Skype, and he explained how this worked, and it also explained it as the primary ideal of anonymous. The posts on 4chan have no names or any identifiable markers attached to them. The only thing you're able to judge a post by is its content and nothing else. This elimination of persona, and by extension, everything associated with it, such as leadership, representation, and status, is the primary ideal of anonymous. And I think this is absolutely right. It is the primary ideal of anonymous. What is interesting is once you leave 4chan, it's a much harder ideal to put into being because you do accrue status and reputation internally. But that's precisely when it becomes interesting, because it's not, you know, determined by the technical parameters of the image board, but you actually have to fight for it, you know. And to me, I found this particularly interesting, and it's a kind of big thread in the book. There's a very famous character by the name of Barrett Brown, who became a kind of de facto spokesperson of Anonymous, and he arrived with his name, Barrett Brown, in tow, and he was kind of kicked out with his name in tow, precisely because he didn't shield his persona or identity. So now just to wrap up, Anonymous may strike the audience is entirely unique, but in reality, their efforts only represent the latest in a long lineage of experimentation with anonymous speech as a conduit for political expression. Offline, anonymous expression has been foundational to our political culture, underwriting monumental declarations like the Federalist Papers. More recently, it was used as a tactic by the Citizens Commission to investigate the FBI. This was a group that broke into an FBI field office in the 1970s to reveal this COINTELPRO. And they were all anonymous until a few months ago, actually, when there's a big book that's been written about them, because now the statute of limitations have passed and they can reveal who they are. Unsurprisingly, the Supreme Court has repeatedly granted anonymous speech First Amendment protection, recognizing the way a method of communicating can shape political impact. Now again, I think anonymous is interesting because it breathes new life, breathes life into this issue by dramatizing its existence through its kind of visual vocabulary. They incarnate the struggle against the constant blanket government surveillance as revealed by Edward Snowden and others. Now, sometimes I think people think, oh, anonymous political acts are cowardly. But I think they can just as easily be following a noble imperative. Anonymous anonymity displaces attention from the messenger to the message. And so, for example, when you often have celebrity leaders like Julian Assange or Abby Hoffman, who was part of the Yippies, a lot of attention gets focused on them as opposed to the issues. And with anonymous, by sacrificing the public self, by shunning leaders, and especially by refusing to play the game of self-promotion, they ensure concealment and mystery. I think this alone is a radical political act, given an order based on ubiquitous monitoring and also the celebration of runaway individualism and celebrity. Their iconography, which is headless suits and masks, it visually displays the importance of opacity. I think the collective may not always be the hive it purports to be. There's a lot of different groups. There's a lot of internal strife and status. But anonymous still manages to leave us with a striking vision of solidarity, of e pluribus unum, which is one out of the many. So I'll just leave it at that and open it up for questions. Thanks. Wow.
What was the reason why you got involved in anonymous?
So I got involved in Anonymous because I had a super secret project about Scientology. And so for a year, I was at the University of Alberta, and there's the largest Scientology archives in the world. And you know, the second I looked at the archival material, I was like, oh, I understand why geeks and hackers hate Scientology, right? It's sort of this perfect inversion, a kind of totalitarian world built around, you know, fake technology and fake science. And in the 1990s, there were these big protests against the Church of Scientology that unfolded on the internet, on Usenet, this mega message board. And I was secret about the project because I was actually scared of Scientology coming after me. They went after a lot of its critics and academics. So I had this project, but I was super stealthy about it. And so then when something by the name of Anonymous in 2008 came into being, I said, oh, you know, here are geeks and hackers once again attacking Scientology. And I decided that it would just make an interesting second chapter to this story. And then, you know, once I kind of learned about its world and you know, once it started to kind of engage in other areas of activism, I was kind of hooked. But it was definitely through Scientology in a very weird way that got me to Anonymous.
Mm-hmm. Did you ever participate in any of the activities?
I did a couple things. So I did like editing of their propaganda material. There's a lot of people Anonymous who are from Europe, actually, and English is not their first language. I mean, there's a lot who do speak English very well, but you know, there's people from like Turkey and Germany and all sorts of places. So I kind of helped people edit their work. I also created one video anonymously with a couple of other people just to see what that was like, you know, just to create something, put it out there. And it was funny because I was pretty proud of the video. I thought the text was really good. And it is quite hard, like, not to be like, hey, that was me that created that awesome text, right? So I think this is why I really do think it is really interesting, where I really do mean that they're experimenting with anonymity. It's not easy, you know, to just create stuff and not lay claim to it. Again, with the illegal activity, you can't. But with a lot of stuff that is created. And then, you know, when it came to the illegal activity, I tried really hard not to watch any of it happen live, just because then, you know, if I found out who that person was, it would put me in a very difficult kind of circumstance and situation. And there was this one time where this one hacker, Jeremy Hammond, who broke into this intelligence firm called Stratford, and he deleted all their files, everything. And 20 minutes before he did, he found me online with a different nickname, not the one he usually used, and said, I'm about to delete all the files of a major intelligence firm. And like my jaw dropped to the like desk. And I felt, at that moment, I thought I was being entrapped. I was like, well, maybe they want me to say, hey, cool, like, can I help in any way or whatever? So I was just like, holy shit. I said, okay, like that's what I typed. And the little, and it's ironic because he wasn't an informant, right? And the other informant was sent to me and interacted with me. And it's really difficult when you're working in these situations to know like who's the informant, who's not. And the kind of atmosphere of paranoia got really intense starting in about the summer of 2011. A lot of nightmares and just a lot of unease that kind of developed as a result. So when it came to the illegal stuff, I tried to really create, you know, a wall. And then I was able to access for my book, I have all these interesting chat logs when people were planning stuff, but that I only accessed because people went to court. And the logs were either part of the court proceedings or were leaked and now could kind of be made public. So the book was only really made possible in its current form because of the arrests.
Despite this being archived with people from Anonymous, do you feel that in the future this group will go down in history as a just reflective of the frustration that a lot of citizens feel towards the way that things are censored towards the public, or because of the media and how it's portrayed, they'll be portrayed as the opposite, not representative?
Yeah, that's a great, like, how will Anonymous be remembered, you know? And, you know, one of the reasons why I raised that issue of, like, the government trying to frame them as, you know, in terms of cyber warfare, terrorism, they're not quite the same thing, but related. And I think it hasn't stuck. You know, I think that while not everyone loves Anonymous, right, they're very controversial, and you see why. Like, they do things that really are meant to kind of ruffle feathers. Nevertheless, there is a kind of a lot of mystique around them, and people tend to generally have a kind of positive attitude towards them. And I think precisely there is a lot of disenchantment with political processes, and people are very frustrated with the ways in which, you know, you can go through regular political channels, but it doesn't seem to achieve anything. And they're kind of like radical, screw you, we want justice, we want it now, kind of captures that sensibility. And I think the media has been generally pretty favorable in terms of the articles I've collected. You know, there's always some exceptions. But definitely one of the reasons why I was really also compelled to write a big book about it in a very kind of quick time, because academics are not known to write a book in a year. And all I did last year was, like, I was glued to my computer writing like crazy, in part because I was concerned about their kind of historical representation. But even independent of me, I think that it would have been positive or more positive and relate to this kind of question of, like, the frustration people feel about an inability to, you know, engage in these regular channels for political change.
Mm-hmm. If an average citizen, anybody, was to search for information about Anonymous, is there a system where you're swept up by some database from the government considered an enemy? A potential enemy of the state. How does one stay anonymous? And do you think that the fear of being swept up keeps more people from joining the Anonymous?
Okay. Yeah, it's a great question. You know, one of the things that's interesting about Anonymous is that, you know, you can't perform the types of data mining on the group and phenomena that you can do in other sites online like Facebook or Twitter. That doesn't mean individuals can be caught, right? Clearly they have been. But, you know, while you know, over a dozen have been arrested in the United States, there are many dozens more who haven't been as well. And their geography is very fragmented. And they are, so after the arrest, many moved off open chat channels to small encrypted ones and group ones, and it became even harder of a kind of geography to map. And sociologically, they're even very difficult to understand, right? It's very hard to say, well, there's these many numbers, this is the class and gender background. I mean, I could say some things, but that's only, again, because if people have been arrested. And I actually think that they do evade what people call data valence. And that's simply because of where they're hanging out on these encrypted chat rooms, because they're using tools like Tor and VPNs. Again, they're not foolproof, but if enough are using them, it does prevent that. But I think you're right. Like, some people definitely are concerned about being swept up, and so may not go there as a result. That said, people have, you know, Anonymous puts out things like documents, how to, use encryption so that you are protected. And there's definitely a lot of newcomers, and that's how they get down this geeky path, precisely by you know, taking on the challenge at some level. But it is self-selecting to some degree, and it's been interesting interacting with people who I'd call more organizers and not hackers, who are understandably worried, because under US law and the Patriot Act, you can be charged with conspiracy by being in the chat room as other people are planning the hacking activity, if that makes sense. So there's a real risk there. Now, there's other organizers and propaganda makers who put up a wall. They only hung out on public channels, which was a good safeguard if they especially weren't saying that they were going to contribute in any way. Or, to take another example, one of the largest Twitter accounts that has over 1 million people, was built up in part by one person. It's multiple people, but one person put in a lot of work. And she was like, I don't go in the chat rooms. She decided to kind of create a wall for self-protection for her and for the account as well. So it is a big worry. But I still think it's fascinating that we have this phenomena that is so difficult to map. And the kind of master metaphor of my book was the maze. And I don't feel like I've fully cracked it or that anyone can. I think that's really great that that exists today. Question back there? Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Back in June, the group ISIS hacked an Anonymous account, and as a retaliation, Anonymous declared Operation No to ISIS on them. Do you think that the United States government will have more support for Anonymous since they're going against the common enemy now?
Yeah, I mean, the short answer is no. I don't think that they will. But it's an interesting question because there's some evidence, just because like you have to go after hackers in the United States. Like there's just no room just but to treat them as kind of criminals who break the law, and there's very, very little leeway. And this existed before Anonymous. This has been in place since the late 80s. But there is evidence, and it's not foolproof, but suggestive, that they will use Anonymous for their own ends if they can. And so the one big example of this is, so I showed the picture of Sabu, who was the informant, and apparently he went to Jeremy Hammond, who was a very, very talented hacker, with a kind of list of requests: hack Pakistan, hack Syria, hack Brazil. And he got a lot of data through those hacks, and obviously the FBI had access to that data. Now, we know from the chat logs that were related to the court case that this happened, absolutely. First, Jeremy Hammond claims this, and this was reported, and then later on, the legal documents were made available. Now, perhaps it was just the case that the FBI was having Sabu do this to look like a legitimate activist. Does that make sense? So he becomes less fishy at some level. On the other hand, it's very peculiar. Brazil, Syria, Iran, you know, why these targets, right? And so one has to wonder, you know, whether when you have, okay, when you have informants in these hacktivist circles, what are they doing with the data that the FBI is also procuring at the same time? Just to give you one final, like, fascinating example that's just a big question mark, probably one of the big mysteries, is Jeremy Hammond hacked this company called Stratford, an intelligence firm. And the company was notified pretty early on about the hack, and Jeremy Hammond didn't download the emails until weeks later and delete things weeks later. And no one knows why, you know, the FBI didn't more aggressively notify Stratford, like, this is going on. Like, why, you know what I mean? Why aren't you protecting yourself? It was like almost, it was either they were too busy with other things or they had hands off. We don't know the answer, but it's interesting when you have informants implanted in hacker groups because of the types of access that they are gaining access to. Mm-hmm. And the last.
Thank you so much for being here and for putting in so many sleepless nights and, no, really, like, putting yourself out there as an academic. I mean, that's so inspiring to see, to be able to then come back and to write this book and to give lectures like this, and I just so appreciate that. On the flip side, I wanted to ask about the gender dynamic. Mm-hmm. In Anonymous and Hacktivism, and just a couple things that came up. One of the graphics you showed, all the best minds from my generation are gone, all white men.
Right.
You know, like, I'm thinking about this audience response, one of her first slides, when, you know, they're going after you for not, you know, doing tits and ass. And our response to that, and a lot of people laughed. A lot of people laughed because I don't think people know how to deal with the fact that, like, that's violent. Like, your head cut off is a really violent, terrifying image. And so, you know, your role as a woman doing this work, but then the larger, you know, gender dynamic from what you could tell about what's going on in Anonymous.
Yeah, so I'm really glad you asked that. So I'm going to start first with just what I think is slightly interesting about pseudo-anonymity, and that I do think that it creates the conditions for what I would not call like radical diversity, but significant diversity. And while a lot of those people featured in that image are all white males, if you look at the composition of lulsec and antisec, it is a bit more diverse than one would think. So lulsec, for example, the people that were arrested included Sabu, who was a Puerto Rican living in a kind of low-income housing in New York City. The person who kind of helped start the hacking wing of Anonymous was a 16-year-old Iraqi immigrant in London, Mustafa Al-Bassam, who moved there when he was six. There were two Irish chemistry students, one of whom's father was in the Irish Republican Army and had been in jail and had done, you know, the hunger strike and was politicized by the time he was 15 years old. And then there was an ex-military who had served time in Iraq as well, you know. And I think that's interesting because I, first of all, don't think they, oh, and then there was an anti-capitalist anarchist hacker, Jeremy Hammond. I don't think they would have ever come together had it not been for the pseudo-anonymity and the fact that you have a domain which says your secondary politics don't matter. So, you know, the what people were there for very different reasons, and that's kind of okay. Now, definitely in the hacker parts of Anonymous, because in the non-hacker parts, you did have organizers who were female, and some really, really important ones as well. You know, Chainology's most famous organizer was a woman. The biggest Twitter accounts, there's women behind them. There's a really key hacker group. There's a woman organizer. There was a lot of transgender hackers as well in Anonymous, and a lot of queer hackers too. Quite a large number. Now, when it comes to the hacking, you know, first of all, it mirrors the kind of general state of gender and computing, which is there's not enough women, you know. And then when you add risk on top of it, you're going to get even less. And so just like with many political domains where, you know, there's already gender dynamics and risk. And then there is, you know, among the hackers, some are just like machisto jerks and some are not. You know, it's a real kind of mix, but there is a kind of milieu or culture that can kind of get created. Now, when it comes to the sort of like the beheading, let's just say, which, you know, I definitely have become desensitized to a lot of this stuff, in part because it's also so extreme. I've just had to kind of notice that dynamic. This is something I struggle with quite a lot. Like, definitely, if someone is ever targeted as a person, I'm just like, you know, they should be found and prosecuted. That's just harassment, you know. The sort of just playing with language and general concepts, I'm torn about that, you know, because I do think that there is something important about transgression. But unfortunately, I think on the internet, so much of that then just bleeds very easily into harassment as well. And one of the things I do like about Anonymous, the activist spaces, is it is contained, it is controlled, insofar as they do see themselves as fighting for social justice and politics. And that doesn't necessarily excuse you know, what they always do, but there are mechanisms for control that in other spaces of transgression, when you don't have mechanisms of control, it spirals completely out of control as well. And then I'll say one final thing too. There's a really great book coming out on trolling by Whitney Phillips, and she makes a couple of arguments that, you know, trolling parrots and accentuates, you know, sexist and racist trends, for sure. But it also is more complicated than just that, you know, that they're also mimicking media sensationalism and trying to kind of outdo that as well. So there's a milieu that kind of helps create that. And also she's interested in, she makes the argument that trolling is a kind of distilled example of cynicism and irony that exists more generally as well. And I think that's quite right too. And that's again why I was fascinated by Anonymous, because they've kind of conquered that kind of extreme cynicism to kind of engage in a hopeful politics. But a lot of people Anonymous recognize if they get rid of their bite, their transgressive bite, they're not who they are, you know? And I am torn about a lot of that kind of language politics as well. And then after.
I'll just echo what Jess said. I think your work is quite courageous. I'm curious about anonymity versus pseudonymity and how, what the sort of tactical pros and cons are of each one. Mm-hmm.
So that's a great question. I mean, from a purely tactical, like, activist perspective, you know, one could imagine, like, groups of hackers coming together, working together anonymously for 2 months, doing their stuff and saying goodbye. I'll come back a year later with a different name. I mean, from a pure, again, activist perspective, you can get a lot more done and be really protect yourself. In a way that if you do it pseudo-anonymously, you put yourself in danger because you start revealing stuff about yourself. You get really attached. You can't let go. You don't want to go. I'll give you one really good example. That said, there's pseudo-anonymity creates a lot of intimacy. You have a stable name. You get to really know people. You feel comfortable working with them. One can say maybe you can only work together because of the pseudo-anonymity. You see there's that tension there between the two? But there's real dangers in sticking around. And so, for example, Sabu, who, you know, very interesting hacker. He really, you know, he's an outlier. He really... you know, came from a very different world. There was a moment where one group called Backtrace supposedly doxed, identified a bunch of the anonymous hackers, and they got almost everyone wrong except for Sabu. They actually did get him right. And this was in March of 2011. And he didn't leave. He was the only one who knew that they had correctly identified him. But I think he was attached. I think that he gained a lot of meaning from participating in this world, and instead of walking away a few weeks later, which could have saved him and everyone, he remained. This is what I see as his big flaw, not so much being flipped by the FBI, because when you have 128 years dangling in front of you and your kids being taken away, right? He was given very little choice then, but then he had a choice. But he was attached in part because they knew each other so well, and the names did... They do carry so much personality. I mean, Sabu to me was larger than life as a name, you know? But tactically, if people could figure out how to work anonymously, you could pull off a lot, I guess. I mean, I'm not advocating, you know, that they necessarily do so, but there is interesting work that happens that they can do, and you can really protect yourself if you go in for a few months and then become a ghost and vanish and reappear with a different name and identity a year later. There's a question back there.
Do you see, like, hacking as being the future or replacing journalism? And if not replacing, like, what kind of relationship?
So I definitely don't see it as replacing, but definitely has reshaped it and is really, really important with journalism. And, you know, WikiLeaks may not be as big of an organization today, but I think that they were so important for so many reasons. And one of the reasons was this. You know, I've met a lot of journalists through this work, and I've come to really admire and respect what they do, even though I sometimes get really frustrated as well. But they work within real constraints imposed by their organizations. And there's a lot of things. I'll give you, like, the best example of the last decade has to do with James Risen, a New York Times reporter, who basically was the first person to break the story that the NSA was doing warrantless wiretapping in 2005, I believe. The New York Times did not want to publish this story. They prevented him from publishing this story. And you know what he did? He wrote a book about it and said, I'm going to scoop the New York Times. And then the New York Times said, ooh, because they're so into the scoop, like, then they published it. What hackers do by leaking is give more freedom to journalists to publish what they wouldn't be able to do otherwise. And that's why they call it the fifth estate, right? The journalists are the fourth estate, you know, keeping things in check, but you need to keep the journalists in check. Fascinating, you know, and I think, again, like, hackers, between their kind of, they have an anti-authoritarian sensibility, a lot are risk takers, they have these free spaces, are willing to do so. So that's one really important thing, keeping the journalists honest, providing leaks. And then the other element has to do with, I guess, more the non-intrusion side of hacking or leaking with things like data journalism, where you're crunching a lot of numbers, and you know, geeks and hackers are entering the newsroom in greater numbers. And this is where actually also the gender issue becomes so important, as you know, journalism in so many fields become tech heavy. Not having females just, you know, means not having females, and also the, you know, the representation of ethnic groups is really low. I mean, it's a true problem in many fields, precisely because it's so important. I think you had a question. Yeah.
I was going to say the psychology behind is fascinating, and I really enjoy your metaphor with the trickster. And I was wondering first if you drew from like Jungian archetypes with that, and do you think anonymous serves similar purpose as the trickster in the process of maturation and development?
So I'm really glad you asked about the trickster. So, I mean, I was more inspired by Lewis Hyde, who wrote a great book called Trickster Makes This World. And it's, you know, it takes a lot of like more classical anthropological stuff and packages it in a really friendly way, but it's a brilliant book. And one of the things he says in the beginning was that in Western societies, you don't have tricksters except for maybe inartistic figures like Allen Ginsberg. And because for tricksterism to arise, you either need polytheism, so tricksterism doesn't, you know, work very well with monotheistic religions, and he definitely has a point. And he also said, well, it also emerges if you have like deep clashes in values. And, you know, when I read that, I was like, oh no, you know, first of all, I think tricksterism always manifests, you know, I mean, there's always a kind of, in whatever kind of society, but hackers, you know, in general, are the kind of classic tricksters, not just Anonymous, but hackers in general. And it's, you know, they're kind of both their proclivity to prank, but also because they hold power, you know, tricksters often do hold power, they're able to kind of enact this role. And then I also think, you know, given the fact that there is, it's very politically charged as to what the future of the internet should be or the status of information. There you have that kind of perfect milieu of the clash in values that kind of activates the trickster in a kind of more political way, you know? And then again, the internet with your ability to take on multiple personas also lends itself towards the kind of elements that embody the kind of trickster psychology and myth as well. But I will say that, you know, in my book, I'm also trying to make a trickster, because tricksters have to be made, right? Like we consider them in myth, but they have to be historically invented. And so Anonymous, I think, is ripe for someone making them into the trickster, because they spin deception and illusion, and because there's so much art. But at the end of the book, I admit my role is a role in trying to make them into the trickster as well. So, but great question. So I guess that's it. Thank you so much for the great questions.